Hey, Peter here with my FSHD. Today I want to tell you about a recent breakthrough study in neuromuscular disease gene therapy research. It solves a major problem in the field. It's incredibly exciting and has direct implications for FSHD therapeutics.
All right, so here's the study that I'm referring to. Directed evolution of a family of AAV capsid variants enabling potent muscle-directed gene delivery across species. Lead author is my friend Sharif. And his colleagues from the Broad Institute at MIT and Harvard Medical School. And this was recently published in Cell. Okay, and so this is a major breakthrough in delivery of gene therapy that's applicable for many neuromuscular diseases and for sure FSHD. So let's go through it. Okay, so let's make sure that we're all on the same page with what exactly is gene therapy. Okay, so, you know, gene therapy, you know, what people ask sometimes is like taking a pill, and it's actually, no, it's not, you know, it's been compared more to like organ transplant, but in the respect that you're actually fixing the problem, okay, you're not going on dialysis, you're getting a new kidney. Well, here, you're actually fixing the genetic problem, okay, so gene therapy approaches, you know, deliver exogenous genetic material, and it's typically DNA to change the course of a disease. Right, and the goal is to treat the disease at the genetic level by adding new genes or editing existing genes or actually disrupting a gene in the case of some of the approaches for FSHD. You know, or you can go after the mRNA, such as an RNAi approach. Now, of course, there are some risks to gene therapy. You know, there can be immune reactions to the load. You know, you're putting something new into the body, and so there could be reactions to this fixed protein or a new protein. You know, but actually, well, the bigger concern is the delivery of the gene therapy, and that's what this particular study is all about. Is this because we normally deliver it with a virus, and the virus itself, you know, if there's too much of this virus, it actually could cause some problems, and that's what this paper is all about. So as I mentioned, there are multiple gene therapeutic approaches being developed for FSHD. For example, the Harper Lab has several that have been published, follistatin expression, RNAi. Our group is working on CRISPR inhibition, taking that to clinic for FSHD. The Vandermeer Lab has recently published on a base editing technique, and then the Dumenso Lab has shown actually that CRISPR editing itself actually does not work particularly well. So there's multiple approaches being developed in the lab for FSHD, but the trick is going to be getting them to clinic. Okay, so how do you get to clinic? So, you know, that all works in the lab, but, you know, we got to get it to people, right? So the pathway to clinic really has four components, okay? You have R&D, and again, this works really well. We develop these technologies and in cell culture and try them out in animal models. We also use a personalized medicine approach because, you know, a lifetime, one-time shot, you want to make sure it works for this, you know, particular individual. So you can actually do a personalized approach and show that a specific gene therapy works for this particular patient. There's proof of concept and safety. This is, you know, proof of concept normally done in a dish with skeletal muscle cells, can move to mouse models. And ultimately, you know, we're developing mini pig models of FSHD for large animal efficacy and toxicology. But the trick is, or the important part is how to get to clinic, right? This is what we want to do, right? We don't need to keep curing mice. We got to cure people. Okay, and this is where the paper comes into play, right? It's dealing with how to make this delivery vehicle of the gene therapy, this virus, safer, okay? So gene therapy consists of two components, right? You have an activity, your gene therapy, and delivery. Okay, so the activity could be CRISPR inhibition, could be base editing, could be RNAi, whatever. Okay, the key is you want to silence the DUX4 gene or mRNA for both FSHD 1 and 2. You need to have expression of your, you know, your cargo in skeletal muscle. Ideally, you would have little to no expression in unaffected tissues. This is more for safety. And everything, you know, the cargo has to be small enough to fit into the vector for delivery. That's a limitation we can get to some other time, but basically viruses are small and you can't put a lot in them. So that's actually that limits more the technology that you can do with this delivery mechanism. Okay, but that's the trick, right? We want to get into people, right? A lot of the publications you see out there, a lot of the excitement I see in people online on Facebook and stuff, you know, a lot of these things actually have no path to clinic, right? That's, you know, curing something in a dish, curing something in a mouse, that's pretty easy. Curing something in a person, that's very different because you have to deliver this gene therapy systemically. You know, skeletal muscles are everywhere. This isn't just like your nerves, your brain, or your liver. You'll notice a lot of things in clinic go to liver and blood. That's because they're very easy to target. Skeletal muscles, a little bit harder. Okay, a lot bit harder, actually. So how do we do it? AAV, okay, this is adeno-associated virus, and this is a virus that can be injected systemically into your bloodstream, and it'll go throughout your body and deliver the gene therapy. Okay, so adeno-associated virus, currently, you know, it's used because it's very safe virus in general. The virus itself does not cause any problems. There are serotypes that can transduce skeletal muscle. We have to get into skeletal muscle. Viruses have target tissues, and so there are some that can target skeletal muscle. And so far, you can have some efficacious dosing that is at a tolerable level, meaning that's safe levels. But you know, this is really tight to get enough virus in to have a therapeutic effect, but not have so much virus that you have problems. Ideally, you'd also have low immunogenicity, selective skeletal muscle tropism. That's actually what the study's all about. The more virus is attracted, getting into skeletal muscle is one thing, but only getting into skeletal muscle is even better because you can reduce viral load and you can increase safety. And of course, ideally, you'd already be FDA approved, but this is more about speed to get to clinic. Okay, so currently, the dosing is a challenge, right? There are gene therapy trials for Duchenne muscular dystrophy and myotubular myopathy. They use AAV9 and AAVrh74, and these have tremendous viral loads. Look at this, 2 × 10^14 viral genomes per kilogram. That is a ton of virus. You know, that's like national debt level virus. Okay, it's just huge amounts. Okay, and so the problem with that is you need this much in order to get a therapeutic benefit, mainly because a lot of this virus ends up in the liver or the kidneys or into other tissue, non-target tissues. Okay, you just basically, a lot of it's just going down the drain into the sink. But in order to get enough to the skeletal muscle, you have to put in a huge amount. Okay, and what happens is they're starting to see some adverse events, including deaths. Okay, the MTM trials have recently had some deaths. And this really is due to the high viral loads. Okay, so that brings us to this study. And what this group wanted to do is they wanted to basically make gene therapy for neuromuscular diseases safer. And the way they're going to make it safer is by decreasing the viral load that's needed to get an efficacious dose. Okay, and the way they went about that was to create new viral capsids. And capsids are the outer component of the virus that's important for tissue selectivity. They're going to create new viral capsids and select ones that are more specific for muscle, which is the target tissue for the muscular dystrophies, right? And so these are going to be skeletal muscle and cardiac muscle that are going to be more selectively infected. And so more of the gene therapy dose, more of the virus is going to go to the target tissue and less of it is going to go down the drain. Okay, so they developed this new technology. It's actually a really cool way that they went in and did this. So if you want to check it out in the paper. And they were able to show that these new myo AAVs can be administered at a low dose and still get therapeutic efficacy in disease models. And most importantly, of course, is that these myo-AAVs transduce primate muscles very efficiently, okay? Because, of course, we're primates, and that's going to be very important to get to the clinic, right? We don't want to just cure mice. Okay, so, you know, here's just essentially a summary of the key data, is that at 50 to 100-fold lower viral dose in an MTM disease model mouse, they're able to get therapeutic efficacy. Then this is a much lower dose than you need for AAV9. And at these low doses of AAV9, you actually get no therapeutic efficacy. Well, that's because most of this is going down the drain. Okay, where most of the myo-AAV is going to the target tissue, which is where you actually need it. And so this is really important. It not only increases safety, but also, you know, it decreases cost, which, you know, it's another component of gene therapy because these are expensive therapies. So this is, you know, absolutely fantastic for the gene therapy for neuromuscular diseases.
So there you have it, you know, a major breakthrough in neuromuscular disease gene therapy work. You know, it may not seem like much, but you know, curing diseases in the lab and doing gene therapy in the lab and cells and in mice, you know, that we do that all the time. But it's getting at the clinic that is really what's important. And this really helps one of the major problems in getting to clinic, which is to get you an efficacious dose to your skeletal muscles, yet still have it be safe for you, you know, with the systemic viral treatment. You know, this is a great example of the worldwide community of researchers in neuromuscular diseases you know, moving their fields forward and having directly applicable to FSHD. Same thing for CRISPR. The whole world's working on CRISPR. You know, some of it's going to be applicable to FSHD. And so, you know, even though it feels like we're a small little group, we're actually neuromuscular disease, and that research community and the patient community is huge, okay? And so what benefits one benefits all of us. So this is great news. If you have any questions, drop me a line, check out myfshd.org and read more about it. And, you know, hey, it's good, things are moving.